quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting.
The Medical Marijuana. The Medical Marijuana. Radio. Radio. Show.
The Medical Marijuana for you and me. Ah, yeah, the medical marijuana. Whoa, 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 yeah, the medical. It's the medical marijuana show. You knew we know. Oh.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to another edition of Medical Marijuana Radio for a Saturday night, and the date is the 23rd of February, 2013. I'm your host, Larry Love. A couple of things. I'm going to be playing a few news reports that I grabbed off of the internet, and we will have a guest at 20 after. We'll have Morgan from New Mexico Alternative Care. They're out of Farmington, and they're one of the 23 approved producers to get medicine to the patients here in New Mexico. So, before I read the strain report, there was one thing going on today, this week, and that is a Representative Bob Woolley. He's put out a bill 594, trying to change the Linen Air and Compassionate Act. What he wants to do is to have every patient go through a background, criminal background check, federally, nationally, locally, every year. And I don't understand why he wants to do that. I did call his office and ask him to be a guest to explain what's his idea about this, because it's just going to bog up the Department of Health and make it very bad for patients. And I did not hear back from him. Hopefully we'll get him on the show next week. But I did read New Mexicans' newsletter, and they said that he has gone to rewrite something on the bill. I guess we'll find out what he's changing this coming week, but we need to stay on top of this, and hopefully we can get him on next week, and most likely it doesn't have a chance to pass anyway, but I always like to know what gets people to do things like this, so we'll keep you on top of that. Here's the strain report. Many of the producers are sending me their listings of what's available for the upcoming week. And this is for the coming week for Cannaceutics. They will have Critical Jack, Candy Kush, Zero Gravity, Pineapple Express, and Shit. That is what it is. I'd like to know what the genetics on that one is. That was Cannaceutics. Fruit of the Earth coming up this week. OG Kush, Lamb's Bread, Blackberry Kush, Sour Diesel, and Bubba Kush. Again, that is from Fruit of the Earth. High Desert Relief this week will have Blue Dream, Bubba Double Snowman, Island Sweet Skunk. Those are all $13 a gram. Lemon Tree is $12 a gram. New York City Diesel, $13. OG Kush number 18 is $14 a gram. And Romulan AK is $13 a gram. They also have plenty of edibles, dark and milk chocolate, double strength at $12 each, dark chocolate, triple strength at $15 each, gold bars at $10 each, and Muddy Buddies at $10 each. That's High Desert Relief. Minerva, Canna, they will have Alaskan Thunderfuck, G13 Haze, Harvest Blend, Kaboom, Lemon Sour Diesel, Orange Kush, Purple Kush, and White Russian. That's again from Minerva. New Mexican, they will have Sour Tsunami, G13 Haze, Trainwreck, Jack Hare, CBD Z7, that's their high CBD strain. They also have Pressed Keef Hash, which is made from Medicine Woman and G13 Haze. Their 2-gram pucks are $70. Something new by them is Keef Hash Topper. I guess you get that and put it on top of your joint. Made from Critical Plus. It's 1 gram for $35. Something new, Black Temple Hash, Raspberry Kush, it's made from. 1 gram is $35. And they have Trainwreck Popcorn Buds. Again, that's New Mexican. New Mexico Top Organics will have this week Banana Kush, a really excellent one. I advise you to grab that. Jack Star and X's Gum. Again, that's New Mexico Top Organics. And that's the strain report. And I'm going to play a couple of things I found, audio clips from different news reports on the internet, and I'll play some of those for you now. This one, first one, is a former federal U.S. attorney who has come around. He changed his mind. Let's listen to this.
On August 8th,
19 97. Okay, that was former U.S. Attorney Mel McDonald, who has rethinked, I guess, cannabis and what it's good for. And so he's come around. So as soon as it sort of hits home, hits the family, some of these right-wingers do come around, because they do see that it can help people who are sick. The next one I'd like to play is also from Arizona. This is about a gentleman who's in the medical marijuana program there. And they're kicking him out of his house. He got kicked out. He got evicted.
An Arizona medical marijuana patient says he's getting kicked out of his apartment for smoking pot legally. Christine LaCroix with his story and a look at his rights.
Never have.
For Vince Barinski, rolling a joint every day.
What I'm doing is 100% legal in this state.
Is a way of life.
The only thing that really takes the nausea and the nastiness away is to smoke a little weed.
He has cancer, hepatitis C, and a state-approved medical marijuana card that allows him to use and cultivate the drug. He was doing just that in his Mesa apartment until he got a knock at his door.
Hello? Here, I have something for you. I'm like, what? Whoa, step back.
Vince says the management at the Country Park Villas served him with this eviction notice because of his medical marijuana.
I'm being penalized for having a medical marijuana card.
According to the Country Park Villas eviction notice, Vince was evicted for illegal drug activity based on federal law that prohibits marijuana. But state law says something different.
Clearly, a landlord cannot discriminate or penalize anyone who has a medical marijuana card.
Attorney Jeffrey Kaufman, a medical marijuana expert, says the eviction notice cites law that only applies to federally subsidized housing. And in the state of Arizona, landlords cannot discriminate against medical marijuana cardholders.
Cardholders have every right to use marijuana in their private property.
The management at the apartment complex declined an interview and request by 3TV for a statement.
That was not fair. Nowhere near fair.
He says marijuana, a way of life, has now cost him nearly everything in his life. I'm Christine LaCroix for 3TV.
Okay, so again, this gentleman just really should not have been thrown out of his house. I do know of some federal cases where people were in federal housing that they tried to evict, and the medical marijuana patient actually won and got to stay in the federal housing. So we all have to stay vigilant and keep an eye out on what's going on with every aspect of being a medical marijuana patient. Okay, this next one, out of Israel, a report from Israel.
Israeli medical marijuana patients say that the growth and sale of the drug, which is now allowed by Israel's Ministry of Health for patients with a doctor's prescription stamped by the state, is helping relieve severe pain.
We're allowed to give them an amount that is set in their prescription, in the license. And we're allowed to sell them this amount once in every calendar month.
Rivka Halop, an 85-year-old who has suffered from arthritis for many years, said the pain she used to experience was unbearable. But she says the two capsules of highly concentrated cannabinoid, a major constituent of the marijuana plant, which she takes medicinally three times a day, have drastically improved her situation. The medical marijuana taken by patients like Halop is grown in one of the largest marijuana-raising houses in northern Israel. Researchers say that through crossbreeding, they've successfully created 12 strains of marijuana with increased levels of CBD, a chemical substance said to fight inflammation and significantly reduce the levels of THC to limit psychoactive effects. Some have accused big pharmaceutical firms of trying to block medical marijuana from gaining respect in the medical community, but the plant is slowly making its way into medicine cabinets, and Israeli health authorities are now analyzing its export potential.
Okay, well, let's hope we can get some of that good Israeli cannabis over here. Although we have great growers here in New Mexico and a lot of places here in the U.S. But, you know, other countries are just way ahead of us when accepting the fact that cannabis is medicine. And in that vein, here is, this is about a 7-minute piece in regard to research at the University of Massachusetts that they were trying to do. But now that medical marijuana is legal, maybe they'll get a shot at it. But listen to this.
This is WBUR's All Things Considered. I'm Deborah Becker, in for Sasha Pfeiffer. Although Massachusetts is now the 18th state to allow the medical use of marijuana, scientists continue to grapple with understanding the properties of the drug and developing pot into medicine. Some researchers blame the federal government for blocking more study that could clarify marijuana's medicinal benefits. The federal government says marijuana has no accepted medical use and a high potential for abuse, and it recently upheld marijuana's classification in the same category of drugs as heroin and LSD. Lyle Craker is an agriculture professor at UMass Amherst who studies medicinal plants. For more than a decade, he's tried to get permission from the federal government to grow marijuana for medical studies. Enric Doblin is founder and director of the Multidisciplinary Association for Psychedelic Studies, or MAPS, which is sponsoring Professor Craker's efforts. We spoke with both of them, and Doblin said that today, some 40 years after researchers first touted the benefits of marijuana as medicine, they haven't been able to get very far.
And our goal is to try to develop the science that would enable the FDA to evaluate whether marijuana deserved to be a prescription medicine from phase 3 large-scale studies, which have not been conducted yet.
There have been studies conducted that have shown that marijuana is beneficial in some cases.
Yes, there's been studies that are small pilot studies, phase 2 studies, but they don't count for making marijuana into a prescription medicine.
Professor Craker, have you done any research thus far on marijuana and its potential medical properties?
No, absolutely not. That's illegal by federal law.
And have you grown any for research at this point or been able to?
No, ma'am. That's illegal. No, I've never participated in any marijuana use or anything like that. This has to be done legally, completely, for to have any valid type of information that'll be available and stand up to scientific scrutiny.
Why get involved in this and try to grow marijuana for research?
When I first talked to Rick, I said to myself, it's just another plant material. We should be examining this because it has supposedly some medicinal effects. I thought it'd be like just like any other plant. We'd get a license from the DEA to grow the material, and then it could go out to medical doctors to run clinical trials. I found out since it's not as easy as it looks.
Now, it's my understanding that right now, if you want to do research on marijuana, that is federally sponsored research, it all comes from one place at the University of Mississippi. And it's a very strict set of rules for you to be able to do that. Is that what you're opposed to?
No, I'm not opposed to that. What I'm opposed to is the monopoly. We need to have multiple sources so that we can get different types of grade. We can get better grade marijuana onto the testing.
The source is really NIDA. the National Institute on Drug Abuse. The University of Mississippi grows under contract to NIDA. They have a grant, a five-year grant, and then NIDA decides where their marijuana gets allocated. They've actually claimed that they have over 100,000 grams. We've spent 7 years trying to buy 10 grams for research with vaporizers. Vaporizers heat the marijuana up, they don't burn it. And we were rejected after 7 years of effort. We're working right now with MDMA, ecstasy, with post-traumatic stress disorder in veterans. And we're getting great results, and we have approval. We've got a marijuana PTSD protocol that has been approved by FDA and an institutional review board at the University of Arizona. And the Public Health Service and NIDA have refused to supply us the marijuana. Only marijuana has a single producer monopolized by the federal government in the agency that has a vested interest in preventing research being done into the beneficial uses.
So Professor Kraker has petitioned for permission to grow marijuana for research, and this case is still pending. Can you explain?
Yeah. Starting in the year 2000, after I had had, MAPS had had two marijuana studies approved by FDA and rejected by NIDA, so we couldn't do them, I spent a year looking for the Rosa Parks of medical marijuana litigation, and I ended up finding Lyle Kraker. 2001 was the first submission that he made to the DEA for a license. In 2007, the DEA administrative law judge ruled that it would be in the public interest for Lyle to get a license. And the DEA administrator rejected the recommendation. And now we're in the appeals court waiting for a ruling.
And that's in the First Circuit Court of Appeals in Boston.
Yes.
Professor Kraker, what do you make of all of this?
Politics seems to rule as opposed to science, and I feel myself as a scientist, which I think is a struggle for the truth. And I think what we need to find out is the truth about marijuana. Until we can actually grow the material, get some standardized plant material, and be able to test it on human patients, we're kind of stuck here.
Rick, your organization does advocate the use of some drugs, and some folks might say, well, you're just trying to get government approval for studies about drug use.
We're not trying to change the drug laws. We're trying to develop drugs as medicines. The concern that you're raising is, are we biased? Do we have a self-interest? And my response to that, because I do get that question a lot, is scientific methodology. That's what science is for. Everybody has their biases. And so we're trying to develop methodologically rigorous studies that are evaluated by FDA the same way they evaluate evidence for any other drug.
Rick Doblin, who's founder and director of MAPS, the Multidisciplinary Association for Psychedelic Studies, which is sponsoring Professor Lyle Kraker and his work. Rick, thanks very much for being with us.
Thank you.
Also, Professor Lyle Kraker, he's an agriculture professor at UMass Amherst, who petitioned the federal government almost 12 years ago to grow marijuana for medical research purposes. He's awaiting a ruling on his case from the First Circuit Court of Appeals in Boston. Professor Kraker, thanks for being with us.
My pleasure.
We did ask for response from the DEA, and the agency referred us to court documents which argue that the government has both adequate quantity and quality of marijuana for research. NIDA, the National Institute on Drug Abuse, also tells us that between 1999 and 2011, it provided marijuana for 15 of the 18 FDA-approved medicinal marijuana studies that were proposed to the agency. None of those was a Phase 3 study aimed at developing a medicine.
Okay, I want to thank NPR for, they're not letting me play it, I'm just playing it, but I thought it was important for everybody to hear that. Before Morgan calls in, I think I have time to read one article that I think is very important. And this is from several sources. A new study shows cannabis may reverse symptoms of dementia. In what could turn out to be a groundbreaking study, a group of neuroscience research in Australia, I guess that's the name of their company, their research is Neuroscience Research Australia, has been examining if cannabidiol, one of the main ingredients in cannabis, could reverse some of the symptoms of dementia, specifically Alzheimer's disease. Early research for the study has found that it does. In the study, mice were injected with a disease analogous to, I guess that means a disease like Alzheimer's. I'm not sure how to pronounce that. And then given a dose of cannabidiol, the results so far are quite drastic. It basically brings the performance of the animals back to a level of healthy animals, said Tim Carl, one of the study's researchers. He goes on to say, you could say that it cured them, but we will have to go back and look at their brains to be sure. As part of the research, the group also found that treating certain harmful cells associated with Alzheimer's with cannabidiol reduced the amount of harmful protein that they produced. These findings are being presented, this was a couple of weeks ago, at the Australian Neuroscience Society annual meeting. And I found several stories in regard to that, but, you know, federal government has had a patent pending or application in regards to cannabidiol CBD, and in it does say that it's good for Alzheimer's. So, you know, I've said it many times, they're speaking out of both sides of their mouths. They say there's no medical value, and then they say it's good for Alzheimer's and dementia and Parkinson's and multiple sclerosis and CP and all of these things. So we'll have to keep watching other countries that are actually doing a better job than we are. President Obama. So looking at the clock, it looks like it's time for Morgan to call in. If you see the numbers on the screen, let's join the conversation when he calls in, or you can call in and speak with me as well. 575-519-4MMJ in Arizona, 623-399-4MMJ, California, 818-8500-MMJ. Here is... Hi, Morgan, is that you?
It's me. Am I late?
No, you're right on the money, buddy. Welcome to Medical Marijuana Perfect. Radio, and I appreciate
thank
you calling
thank
in.
Thank you very much.
We already
Thanks
read
for
our.
Having me.
Oh, my pleasure, dude. I've you know seen you on Facebook and seen your garden that you're growing for New Mexico Alternative Care in Farmington. So let's hear what strains you have available this week. They weren't among the ones that I read, so let's finish up that piece of business.
We got a bunch of new stuff coming out. I think we got the Deadhead OG coming out, Jack's Cleaner. We have the Lorax, which is a phenotype off of the Plushberry, which the Plushberry will be coming out soon as well. Some new alien genetics that everybody's going to love. List goes on quite a while. Great hash coming out.
How do you make your hash? Is it bubble hash with bubble bags, or do you have another method of making it?
No, sir. Water and ice.
Water and ice. That's the...
Keeping it clean.
Right on.
So,
Morgan, tell us a little bit... about New Mexico Alternative Care. I don't know much about them, and I know that they're in Farmington and covering that part of the state. So give us a little background of, you know, what ordering procedure is, you know, when they got started, and how things are going down there.
We're going on our second year of business. Started out a little bit rough trying to make sure we had the enough meds for all the patients. That's always a struggle, but we do our best. We have a walk-in facility. Come in, talk to Corey or Bree. We'll take care of you. And if you have any questions for me, I'm in the back every day, 7 days a week. You can always find me there. Same procedure. Just give us a call, or we should have our website back up online soon where you can download our form to get registered with us. And kind of the same procedure as the rest of the dispensaries we have here in New Mexico.
Sure. What type of edibles do you have there?
Oh, we got some great stuff over here. We got we just started doing cookies, take and bake, some chocolate chips, some, let's see what else, oatmeal raisin, oatmeal chocolate. We got chocolate chews. We're doing a bunch of all different kinds of candy, suckers, cinnamon drops. Just started doing a white chocolate cherry chocolate chew, which is going to be amazing. All our edibles are made with Keith, so really, really clean stuff.
Are you making butter or using coconut oil with the keef, or what are you doing to extract?
Right now our cook is still using butter. We're gonna hopefully soon get her going on the coconut oil, as that right now is probably the best extraction method for edibles that I can think of. I mean, THC bonds with fat, and I mean, what you got with coconut oil?
Right,
97% fatty. So
right, it's a little bit
good stuff.
A little bit healthier than butter, although butter really, has good fat in it that sucks out the THC and the cannabinoids and all that stuff. So, what about, are you doing any gluten free stuff for people that have gluten problems?
Most definitely, yeah. Most everything that we do, we also have something to follow with it that's gluten free as well.
Mm-hmm.
We're trying to cater to a little bit of everybody and doing sugar free stuff. I mean, anything we can just to get it to everybody. Because everybody's got their own illness. Some people can't eat that type of stuff, so we got to cater to them as well.
And as far as strength is concerned, are all of your edibles pretty much the same strength, or do you have some that are stronger than others?
You know what? We haven't started making anything stronger than anything yet, because our edibles right now are pretty potent, and everybody seems to be happy with them. We haven't had anybody come back with any complaints, so we've kind of just left them the way they are. But if we start getting people asking for stuff that's stronger, I mean, it doesn't take much, doesn't take long, and we can definitely get it done.
Right, right. Well, I find that, I worked the front end of a dispensary for 2 years here in Santa Fe, and I found that a lot of people have never had edibles before. And it can be quite different if someone, let's say, ate a whole cookie or a brownie the first time they ever ate an edible. So do you instruct them to maybe try a half or something first? Because if you have a bad experience eating cannabis, you may not go back to it, even though it can be a really great help to your condition.
Most definitely, yeah. You got to make them aware. You got to let the patients know that, I mean, if it's something new to them and it's something that they've never tried before, to take it with ease. I mean, try a little piece, wait a little bit, see how it goes. If it doesn't get you what you need, I mean, eat a little bit more. But yeah, we don't definitely encourage anybody to go home and just eat the whole thing just to try it. So mm-hmm. Yeah, no, definitely. We kind of take it by a patient basis. And we become friends with most everybody that walks in our door. So they're our friends. We don't want them to have a bad experience.
Constantly having enough supply for the amount of patients that you have, or are there times when you're out of medicine?
It's tough. Having a walk-in facility, we do run out occasionally, but we are getting to the point to where when we do run out, it's a few days.
Uh-huh.
It's not that long. But are working on... Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, you're probably talking about bud, right? I mean, every once in a while you run out of bud, but
flowers. As far as edibles, medibles, teas, all the different things like that, we're always open for that stuff. But as far as the flowers go and the buds go, yeah, occasionally there's a few where we do run out. But we are working on a new perpetual harvest to where we should have a stockpile of this stuff. So if everything works out the way it's planned, we should be all right.
Well, like I said, again, I've seen your garden in pictures that you've posted, and I'm quite impressed with that. So tell us a little bit about your growing procedure. Are you doing dirt, hydro? What's going on over there?
I'm in soil. I love soil. It's user-friendly. We're actually getting ready to... switched to the air pots. We were using 15-gallon containers, and I was having, believe it or not, issues with root circling and getting root bound. So these air pots are kind of a new technology. They've been around quite a while, but only overseas. As you said before, we're quite behind on some of this stuff.
I think most people don't really know what air pots are, and also what size. When you said that your soil and pots were getting sort of root-bound and twirling around, what size pots were you growing in?
15-gallon.
15? Uh-huh.
Yes, sir.
So
we have some amazing roots.
So tell us a little bit about what air pots are.
Air pots are just, it's a self-pruning technology. They actually, if you look at them, it looks like a egg carton, just the different dimples and things that it has.
Uh-huh.
But they have holes. And the self-pruning is when the roots start to grow to the edge of the pot, it'll actually kill off the end of the root, stopping that root from growing and giving more roots more room to grow instead of the root growing out longer and just binding itself up. So it just gives you a better root system, which ultimately gives you a better plant.
It's still in soil, though.
Oh, yes.
Still growing in soil.
Yes, most definitely still in soil.
Yeah.
But these pots, they're versatile. I mean, you can use them in high, ebb and flow systems for where it's bottom feeding. You can feed from or water from the top, water from the bottom, either way. So they're very versatile pots. So if we ever did decide to do anything, I mean, there wouldn't be much of a change.
I did read somewhere this week when reading up on doing raw cannabis, juicing it and so forth, where they said that there's some really good medicinal value in the roots themselves. So you ought to think about, read up on that, maybe think about how to maybe harvest your roots, because I think that's going to be something that we're going to be listening, hearing a lot about in the near future. You know, you have to keep...
Most definitely. I mean, there's... Go ahead.
I was just going to say that, you know, the whole plant has just so much in it that seems to be beneficial that, you know, you can just, I read every week, I just try to read as much as I can, and I learn things new all the time. You know, because of the prohibition on cannabis for the last 80 years, we don't know as much as we should. So new things are happening all the time. So, you know, even though we may think we know everything, we don't.
No, it's an endless field of knowledge. I mean, the plant has unlimited medicinal properties that we're still discovering every day. And like you said, I mean, underneath the plant, the roots. I mean, who would have thought to start trying or using something like that? So, I mean, yeah, endless possibilities.
So, are you?
They got to give us a chance.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, give pot a chance. We that's a little John Lennon thing.
There you go.
So tell me, are you at the 150 plant count, or are you below that to where you can actually sell clones to some of the patients that want to grow their own?
We do clones on request, but normally what we've been doing is just clippings. So that doesn't affect our plant numbers.
Okay, so
it's just as they come.
So you'll be selling clippings to patients that they'll have to root themselves.
Yes, they have to root themselves, and a lot of these patients that come in and get these, they're well aware of how to do that, and if they're not, we definitely take the time to show them everything that they need to do to get the plant rooted.
And
if patient, go ahead.
So if you're growing 150 plants, how many different strains do you have going at one time? And do you separate your rooms by indica and sativa, or are they all in the same place? How do you how many strains are you growing at one time, would you say? Because I know how hard it is. The different strains have different flowering times and so forth.
Oh yeah, most definitely. Well, unfortunately right now we only have two rooms. We have one room for veg, one room for flower. They're decent size, and at any given time, I mean, we've been pushing out a lot of new strains and keeping the stuff that we know the patients like, just to kind of keep the best of the best. And at any given time, 9-10 mm-hmm. strains going on in there, all in the same rooms, but we do keep them separated by their genetics.
So as far as vegging is concerned, are you vegging different strains at different lengths of time, or are you just vegging everything to the same time and then pushing it into flower?
We do it strain specific. Every plant's different. Every mm-hmm. plant requires different times growing. And if you want the end product to turn out the way it needs to turn out, try to treat your plants different. I mean, because they are all different. There's not one that is the same.
And let's say, as far as harvesting is concerned, what are you looking for when you think a plant is ready to be harvested?
Just the overall, the trichome production, we use a scope. We check that for our quality, if we're clear still, or if we're getting milky, if we're starting to get amber, depending on the strain. That'll also tell us when we want to pull it. Heavy indica, we're going to let it go a little bit more amber, mm-hmm. give it a little bit more potency. On the sativas, we keep those a little bit more milky just to get everybody through their day if they're medicating in the morning. And then we also, just physically looking at the plant without a scope, you can just by the pistils, I mean, you want 50% of them, 75% of them, changing to the color that they're going to change to. Because if you end up getting a lot of them, just the white hairs, your product's not going to be as potent as it should be.
Right. Well, you know, I'm sort of an old school guy, you know, because I started growing some plants back in the 70s. And, of course, at that time, we weren't so scientific, okay? We didn't know about trichomes. We'd never seen a trichome. We weren't looking
right.
at stuff. So the old rule of yeah. thumb used to be when the white hairs, as that we call them, were halfway down red or brown, you would pull the plant. And so
yep.
that's what we used to do. But now, you know, just because there's been just so many more years and of experimenting and growing, and it's really gotten to be a heck of a science. And I sort of take my plants in stages. I've mentioned this before. I'll take some when they're clear to milky. I'll take, you know, some maybe some mm-hmm. branches, and I'll let the rest of them go maybe another week or so, and take some when they're all milky, and then leave some to go a little bit amber. And so I sort of get three different kinds of medicine out of one plant, and I
out of one strain, yeah,
out of one strain, and I date them so that I know what they are. And of course, if they're, you know, clearer, you know, you're going to get more of an up kind of high, and then milky, I guess straight milky is what everybody really, I think, is looking for. So it's really interesting. The technology just and the science has just come so far in my lifetime, for sure. And it's really great to you know, read up on things and talk to different growers. Everybody's got you know, different methods and so forth. Tell me, what kind of nutrients do you use in veg and then in flower?
In veg and flower, we use UBO Grow. If you haven't heard of it, check it out. The stuff is amazing. Made by a really good friend of mine, Tom. UBOGrow.com, definitely check it out. It's 100% plant composted material. It's super, super clean, super user-friendly. that's our main. And then we also are using some of the Canna products, the Bio line.
Uh-huh, Canna Bio, yes. That's out of England,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Is that out of England? Are they?
A lot of most all of this stuff is overseas and is slowly trickling into the U.S.
Uh-huh.
But yes.
Have you heard about Kyle Cushman and his Veganics? He's got a line of veganic nutrients that either out now or coming out any minute.
I'm super super excited to check that stuff out. It's the OGTs or something like that, I believe it's called.
Not real sure. I know that Kyle calls it Veganics because there's no animal products in it at all. And he says you can throw away your pH meter, you know, once you start rolling on this stuff. And by the way, for more information, for you and for everybody else out there, Kyle Cushman has his own website now, kylecushman.com. And everybody should go there and check out what he's doing. So let's talk more about, we almost covered everything as far as the growing, but let's talk now about the cure, because you can grow really dynamite plants, and if you have a bad cure, you know, all that work for months and months is down the drain. So tell me a little bit about your curing.
We actually have our own room for drying and curing. A lot of our plants, they get trimmed up as soon as they get cut down, and hang everything on the dry racks until they're ready. Our room is climate controlled, so we keep all our temperatures and our humidity and everything on point. All of our lights in there are green lights, so the buds, while they are drying or curing, don't get any type of UV light out of there. But curing and drying, that is one of the most important parts of growing. I mean, if you can't cure and dry your bud properly, then you have wasted quite a bit of time.
Yeah, well, you know, I have some stuff, you know, of course, I grow outdoors once a year for myself as a patient grower. And, you know, my stuff is, you know, right now I've got a cure on it since October. And, you know, it just the terpenes and just the aroma and the flavors just really flavor. Come out, you know, if you keep it a little bit longer. I use, after glass jars for a period of time, everything goes into these Volive Myron jars, which are cobalt blue and they're UV protected. And I got to tell you, these jars are absolutely incredible. And they're around. And I have stuff that from my 2011 grow, I grew some Jack Hare and some Sugar Black Rose and a couple of others. And I still have, you know, some left. And it's in these Myron jars. And when you take a bud out of there, it still feels like it's fresh. And it's amazing for long-term storage. Everybody out there needs to check out those Myron jars. So so how long from do you hang them before you cut them off and then go to the next step of curing, which is either trimming first or tell me, how long do you leave them hanging?
They'll hang from anywhere from 7 to 21 days, just depending on the strain, just because we do want the best end result. And so, yeah, anywhere from a week to almost 3 weeks, we'll wait. And then, like you said, I mean, if we have the time, we are going to take to let our stuff cure a little bit longer, just so you get a better quality, better tasting, better smell out of your end result.
And are you burping your jars once they go in there for a period of time and then leaving them shut? How long do you burp them for?
We actually have a position there. Give a shout out to Obi-Wan out there. He's my man. He takes care of all that, but throughout the day, depending, like strain specific as well, anywhere from 2 minutes to 30 minutes a jar, depending on what it needs. If it's closer to being finished, we won't burp it as long. If it needs a little bit longer, up to 30 minutes.
That's a day you're talking about, 30 minutes a day?
Yes, uh-huh. I'm sorry.
And then
that's as little as just opening and closing it, just depending on how far along it is.
Right, and then at some point, just got to leave them shut and they're done, because you don't want to dry them.
Yep.
Basically, you want to get the chlorophyll out of there. That's sort of the hardest part that some people make mistakes on. They think it's dry, and they think it's dry enough to smoke, and it is dry enough to smoke. To get the chlorophyll out is really the important part of the cure. And let's see, tell me, is everything one price per gram at your place, or different strains command different prices?
Everything has been the same price for the longest time, but some of these new genetics that we're going to be bringing in took us a lot to acquire them. So we were thinking about our top shelf stuff a little bit more expensive, and this is also going to help us keep a little bit more product on the shelf for patients that come in, because we found keeping everything the same price, it goes so much faster, and a lot of the patients aren't able to get access to what they want. So we figure if we maybe have a little bit higher end stuff that people use special occasions, I don't know, but it'll be your 26-27% THC stuff that you'll see on that top shelf. It'll be a little bit more expensive.
I don't think I've ever, well, not that I know of, I don't think I've ever smoked anything that was 26 or 27%. That's really high. Are you testing for CBD and for THC?
Yes, sir. Everything that we grow gets tested out of Albuquerque, and I feel really bad right now. I can't remember the name of the gentleman's lab.
Is it Page?
Oh, yeah.
Is it Josh at Page?
I'm sorry?
Is it Josh at Page Analytical?
No. No, it doesn't sound right.
Okay, well, you know, there are...
Marijuana.com or something like that, but he's out of Albuquerque, great guy. We test for all the chemicals, all the molds, all the everything, THC, CBD, CBN. Mm-hmm. We test for all that stuff. And a lot of these new alien genetics that we have been testing through the roof.
So. Wow. So what strain is tested the highest, and what was that for THC?
Well, I'm hoping we got some test results coming back pretty soon, hopefully within the next couple of days. And I believe this, some of this alien genetics that we have is going to test up in the high 20s. We've had some lemon skunk come back at 23%.
Nice.
THC, 3% CBD, and 0.11 CBN. So we got some quality medicine over here at New Mexico Alternative Care.
Well, tell us a little bit about, do you use any delivery service where people in other parts of the state can get your great genetics? Because I know that, you know, you have walk-in available in Farmington, but are you using anybody to, let's say if I wanted to order something, I'm a patient, can you get something to me?
Oh, you're making me feel bad. And unfortunately, we don't have any type of delivery service. We don't use a delivery service. Mm-hmm. Again, well, it's a thing to where our medicine goes so fast as it is. If you call and let us know you're coming, go ahead.
I was going to say, okay, I'm going to finish your sentence for you. Obviously, people can call in, order something, and they can drive over and pick it up. But I want to let you know, just in case you don't know, and in the future when you do have more medicine, when your crops are reaping a little bit more. Josh over at Natural RX, they will deliver all around the state for, I don't know, $10 or $15. And he's made himself available to, a lot of different distributors of the 23 producers here in the state. So you might want to check into that because that's reasonable. You know, $10 or $15.
Yeah, no, that's not bad at all, and especially being able to potentially get our meds to people down south. I mean, that would be amazing because I know we have people that drive from down south now, and I know that someday I'd like to have someone come to their door for once, you know. So
sure.
So no, I'm very aware of that. And
yeah. Get in touch with Josh over there. He's doing a great job just getting medicine from everybody to everybody, and I really admire the fact that he does that. You and I spoke a little bit about genetics earlier. You mentioned some seeds. Do you sell seeds at New Mexico Alternative Care?
No, sir. We don't sell seeds at New Mexico Alternative Care, but I am a representative for Money Tree Genetics, MTG Seeds. .com. Check them out. What we're doing now is I'm taking orders over the phone. If anybody's interested, as far as getting their genetics, because I know it's very hard for anybody to get quality genetics as far as seeds. It's next to impossible.
Yeah, it really is tough.
So whatever we can do to get these to some of these patients, I mean, we're going to make sure that happens.
And can you please, I'm going to write this down. What was the name of that company? You said Money Tree Genetics?
Yes, sir. Money Tree Genetics. And the website is actually mtgseeds.com.
mtgseeds.com. Great. I'm definitely going to check them out myself.
There's some great people.
Like I say, I'm a patient grower for myself, and I all during the winter, which is what I'm doing now, is I'm researching different strains, and then I put out a list to some of my friends and some people that I know to see if they have any access. I call it my wish list, and so it,
there
it's,
you go.
It's a lot
Everybody
of fun.
Got one.
Yeah. Listen. Last year, I did go to my wish list, and everything turned out just beautifully. So, everybody, check out Money Tree Genetics, which is mtgseeds.com. And is there anything else that we didn't touch on that you would like to talk about New Mexico Alternative Care? What was the impetus? Who are the principals there, the people that got this started for you? Are you one of the principals there?
as far as who got the place up and running?
Yeah. So who are they, did it take them a long time to get approved? I know the process here in New Mexico takes a long time.
Yeah, well, you know how the application is. It's you get that thing filled out, send in a bunch of money, and you just sit back and keep your fingers crossed and hope that they approve everything. Unfortunately, I don't want to name names because a lot of them are just great people in the community, and, uh-huh. and I don't know if they're wanting to everybody to know, but it's hardworking, run-of-the-mill, everyday kind of person. I mean, uh-huh. and they're just here to give people a safe access to a medicine that they deserve, a medicine that's is safe.
Mm-hmm.
We've had patients. We also do the cure oil. I'm sorry, I forgot to mention that.
Oh yes. Let me hear about that, because I know a few people right now that are dealing with stuff, and they're going to want the cure oil. Tell us a little bit about how you do your cure oil, and a little bit about that's the Rick Simpson cure oil. What are you using for a solvent?
We use the 99% alcohol. I think it's
ethanol.
I can't remember the brand off the top.
Is it like
I think that's it.
Ethanol
remember.
Probably from a liquor store or something. I was saying probably ethanol.
No. No. It's actually an alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a very extremely, I mean, it's a high level of alcohol, but it's not like something you pick up at the liquor store.
Okay.
It's similar to the same process that Rick uses himself. But no, great results. You can eat it. You can use it as a topical. And amazing results. We've had patients come in that have had eczema for their whole life, and they've been dabbing it on wherever the eczema's at, and they no longer have it. And to hear stories like that,
amazing. I know. I love hearing those kind of stories.
Yeah.
How do you sell the cure oil? In what strengths or what? How is it sold?
It comes in an oral syringe.
Mm-hmm.
You can get it in the smallest dose or the smallest size I believe we have is 1 milliliter, and up to a 5 milliliter oral syringe. And right now that's how we're packaging it and getting it out to our patients.
So do you know people that are actually using it with the Rick Simpson protocol, which is starting with a low dose and then moving up to a gram a day, to the point to where you ingest 60 grams in 90 days? Are you doing it? Are people doing that?
Oh yeah, most definitely. We have a few different regimens, and that's probably one of our main ones. But we had a veteran come in that had leukemia, and he had started using it, and of course at the same time going to the doctor. And 6 months of him on this cure oil, the last appointment that he had gone to, he was cancer free.
And how much did he start with, the low dose and build up, or how did he dose himself?
He did start with a low dose. He started with the size of a granule of rice,
right?
And then he realized he wanted to. It wasn't affecting him as bad as some other people. So he wanted to speed things along a little bit more. So he upped his dose, but keeping it on the same regimen.
Okay, well, that's fantastic to hear.
Great news.
So you know, the milliliter thing, I'm still not, I can't convert milliliters into grams. So how many milliliters would be in a gram of oil, do you think? Do you have any idea?
I think we can probably compare it to maybe like 1.5, 1.3 grams maybe.
I see, okay.
Of oil?
I just don't know the conversion.
If I'm correct.
So,
yeah, I don't either. I'm just thinking off the top of my head.
If your patient that went through this, if you could get in touch with him and see if he'd come on my show to talk about his experience, he can come on anonymously. He doesn't have to say who he is. But I would love to speak to someone who has been totally through that Rick Simpson protocol, because it is tough. There's a point in time where you're taking such a high dose that you can hallucinate, you can be uncomfortable, and you have to be able to handle that. So if you could get a message to him, and if he would want to come on sometime, I would love to have him on and to hear all about that. So we only have a couple minutes left to close the show out. Is there anything that you'd like to mention? How to get in touch with New Mexico Alternative Care? You said the website's not up now, but is there a phone number you'd like to give out?
The phone number, 505-716-2211. That'll get you straight through. Give us a call Monday or Tuesday through Saturday.
Oh, okay. So you're closed Sundays and Mondays, but you're open Tuesday through Saturday. That's great. Saturday is a great day. People aren't at work, and it's a good time for them to go out and get their medicine. So, Morgan, thank you very much. I appreciate you coming on. I'll be catching you on Facebook, and good luck to everybody, and the best to the patients of the Farmington area. And I thank you for calling in today and letting the people of New Mexico and all around the country know what New Mexico Alternative Care is doing here in New Mexico. Thank you, Morgan.
You got it. Free the plant. Free the plant. Thank you.
Absolutely. Free the plant. We'll be right back. Okay. I'm going to play one quick little tune, and then we'll close out the show.
Hare Krishna.
Well, that last cut was from the original off-Broadway show of Hair, reminding us that, you know, we all, back in the 60s, started using cannabis recreationally, but now we've grown into using it medically, because we didn't know back then what was going on. But we've come a long way. I want to thank Morgan from New Mexico Alternative Care in Farmington. Give them a call. And check out Money Tree Genetics, which is mtgseeds.com. I want to thank my two radio mentors, both with the initials HS. Thank you very much for your inspiration. Don't forget to fcannabis.com, Wells Fargo, and Bishop's Lodge for being unfriendly to medical marijuana patients. And one more F. Let me check my papers here. I can never find it, but you know who you are. And we love everybody out there. We'll be back next week with a great guest. Thank you for listening. Feel well.
Shabbat. Shalom.
Feel well, everybody.